Good morning, everybody. I'm Gay Grunfeld. I'm a member of the Conference Executive Committee, and I'll be your moderator for our panel today, What Are Potential Solutions to the Homelessness Crisis? Thank you for joining us at this early hour on this, our last day of the conference. I moved to San Francisco in 1985, and I have been confronted with this issue ever since. I also encounter it in my work representing incarcerated people. But I had a lot of misconceptions, and I'm very grateful to my law partners and to Judges Wansley and, well, for the whole Conference Executive Committee for supporting this panel, especially. I would like to thank Judges Simon and Wansley and Renee Lorda for their support, as well as the other members of the subcommittee who worked with me to put this panel together, and that is LRCC Chair Misty Perry Isaacson, Clerk of the Court for the District of Montana, Tyler Gilman, and Magistrate Judge Laurel Beeler. We've been given 90 minutes for this topic. We will leave about 15 minutes for your questions. Please write as legibly as you can. You can read our materials as well as a recent groundbreaking report called the California Statewide Study of People Experiencing Homelessness, as well as the full bios of our speakers on the conference website or on your phone app. We're very fortunate to have three distinguished experts with us today. You will learn from them that homelessness is a problem that can be solved. Houston and other cities have made huge strides, as has the Department of Veterans Affairs. And I just learned from another judge here that Chico is making good progress, Chico, California. This is a topic that is difficult, but it's especially relevant to the Ninth Circuit, and especially during this time of extreme weather that some of our states are experiencing. For now, I will briefly introduce to you, from my left, the Honorable Anise Parker, former mayor of Houston, America's fourth largest city, where she made huge strides in addressing Houston's homelessness crisis. Next, we have Professor Emeritus Gary Blasi of the University of California at Los Angeles School of Law, who has written and studied homelessness and represented unhoused individuals for years. And then Professor and Dr. Margot Cushell of the University of California at San Francisco School of Medicine. She is the director of UCSF's Center for Vulnerable Populations and the Benioff Homeless and Housing Initiative. I begin by asking each of you, what drew you to this topic?
I approached it from both a professional and a personal level. It is a challenge for every major city. It's one that can't be ignored. It has to be addressed, but it is very challenging to solve. And I will confess that when I first started tackling it, had a little bit of the, I'm from Houston, we put a man on the moon, we can get that person housed. But I also came from it from a personal standpoint. My wife and I have a 47-year-old son that when he was 17, he was living on the streets of Houston when he came to live with us. We also have three daughters who were adopted out of foster care. Among them, they have five brothers. One was adopted, four aged out. Of those four who aged out of foster care, one is an addict on the streets of Houston somewhere. One is spending the next 20 years of his life in prison, and the other two are in and out of homelessness. It is a problem that we have to address.
Thank you. And you, Professor Blasi?
Well, I didn't so much come to the problem as the problem came to me. 1983, I'd been a legal aid lawyer in Los Angeles for 5 years, primarily representing tenants in slum housing. 1983, there was a big recession, and increasingly, the tenants who were coming in were former tenants because they had lost their housing and they had absolutely nowhere to go. So basically, I moved my practice to where the clients were.
And Dr. Cushell.
I come to this work as a physician who continues to practice at San Francisco General Hospital, which is the public hospital for the city and county of San Francisco. When I came there in the mid-90s as a resident physician, half of the inpatients we cared for were experiencing homelessness. And as a resident, my job would be to take exceptional care of them, to do all sorts of fancy medical things, spend all sorts of money, and then I would forcibly send them back to the streets, and a few days later, they would return to us. Any progress we had made was undone, worse than they were, and I realized then that if I really cared about my patients' health, the single best thing I could do would be to address their homelessness, and there I am today.
And we're lawyers and judges, so we have to have a few definitions. Let's throw one out, please, Dr. Cushell, and then we'll turn to Mayor Parker.
So when we talk about homelessness, we mostly abide by the federal definition of homelessness from the Hearth Act of 2009. And the Hearth Act sets out the definition as basically any individual or a family who's living outside in a place not meant for human habitation, who's living in an emergency shelter. It also includes people who are exiting institutions like jails or prisons, who entered without housing, who entered homeless and don't have a place to go, those at imminent risk of losing their housing if you have a 14-day eviction notice or other credible reasons to think you'll be outside in the next 14 days, and those fleeing domestic violence with no other place to go. Youth and children have a slightly expanded definition under different parts of the government.
And there's so many terms and acronyms I've learned about. Mayor Parker, could you take us through the most important and relevant ones?
First, let's talk a little bit about the terms homelessness and houselessness. And obviously, our title today was about homelessness, but practitioners today tend to use the term houselessness instead of homelessness because it really does a better job of capturing the psychology of people on the street. And that is that that tent is their home. That bridge abutment that they put their sleeping bag under is their home. And when you're working with people to try to get them off the street, you have to understand that emotionally and psychologically, they have created a home for themselves. They may not have a house, they may not have a shelter, but they have a home, they have neighbors, they have a neighborhood, and it has to be addressed more holistically. But there are other terms as well that we probably should all come to some agreement on. One is unsheltered, individuals with a primary nighttime residence that is a public or private place not designed for sleeping. Sheltered is a homeless person residing in an emergency shelter or some form of transitional housing. Vehicles can be included in that. Displacement sweeps, this is when entities do forced movement of individuals living in encampments. Continuum of care is a local or regional planning body that is responsible for coordinating funding and delivery of services for people experiencing homelessness. Every community in America is covered by some version of a continuum of care. There are more than 400 across the United States. I will say that it is an aggregation of, they tend to be aggregation of entities, and less about coordination than about conferring with each other about which grants to go for. I'm just gonna put that out there. Permanent supportive housing is an intervention that is necessary for a lot of the folks who are moving out off the streets, and that is continuous housing assistance with voluntary support services to address the constellation of issues that a lot of these folks may experience. And then housing first versus treatment first. Housing first is the best practice in terms of how do we deal with people who are chronically on the street, and that is you can't deal with substance abuse, you can't deal with mental illness when someone is not in a stable living environment. Put them in a stable living environment, then work to fix the other problems. In essence, that's what Housing First means. And then a point in time count, all of our homeless funding is driven by point in time counts, which is a snapshot once a year in January that takes place across the United States where every city goes out and tries to figure out how many people are on the street in that point in time on that night. And then I'm also going to point out that a lot of what drives probably you to this conference panel this morning is visible people on the street. And I think we need to make a distinction that a lot of what you see, open air drug use, is not the same thing as homelessness. And while there's an overlap in the populations, they're two distinct and different problems. Open air drug use is particularly acute right now in Portland, but that doesn't mean that those folks don't have someplace to go sleep at night. And we're going to try to wrap all of that into our conversation today.
And speaking of point in time counts, Professor Blasi, you want to talk about this slide? And
yes, 582,462. That was the most recent point in time count for all of the jurisdictions in the United States. 248,819 of them were in the jurisdictions covered by the Ninth Circuit. That works out to be 43% of all the homeless, unhoused, whatever term you use, persons in the United States. More importantly, I think in many ways, it's 73% of the unsheltered homeless are in the Ninth Circuit. And we're going to be talking about why that is, and I'm going to pass this along to Dr. Cushell.
Dr. Cushell, talk to us about why people are homeless.
So I think it's important to unpack that question because there are often two different questions in that that get conflated, and when they get conflated, you wind up sometimes with the wrong answer. So in a terrific book, In the Midst of Plenty, by Mary Beth Shin and Jill Kaduri, they separate two questions that people sometimes confuse. The first question is, why are there so many people in a region that are homeless? Why in the Ninth Circuit do we have so many more people who are homeless than our share of the population overall? When you ask that question, as I hope we will prove to you today, the answers are structural. It's about the shortage of affordable housing and other structural solutions. But when people ask that question, they also often mean to ask, why is this particular person homeless? And when you ask that question, the answers are more what I would call individual, things like someone's individual disabilities or issues like substance use problems or mental health problems. In the early 2000s, Marty Bird and Lauden Aaron talked about homelessness as caused by an interaction between structural factors. These are affordable housing, income inequality, wages for low-wage workers. An interaction between that and these individual vulnerabilities, substance use and mental health disabilities, adverse childhood experiences, involvement in the child welfare system, and then the presence or the absence of a safety net, whether they're income support, safety net healthcare, or other services. And they pointed out that the less favorable the structural factors and availability of the safety net is, the fewer individual vulnerabilities one needs to experience homelessness. So if you go to Northern Europe, where the income structure is relatively flat, they have lots of affordable subsidized housing, there's a strong safety net, you will still see people experiencing homelessness, but those people will be those with really significant individual vulnerabilities. In the Ninth Circuit, in the United States, those folks with individual vulnerabilities are disproportionately homeless, but many, many others who don't have those individual vulnerabilities are as well. And finally, in another terrific book, Homelessness is a Housing Problem, by Clayton Aldern and Greg Colburn, they differentiated between the drivers, the systemic factors that create overall homelessness rates and explain the differences in homelessness rates between regions. So Ninth Circuit versus everyone else, lack of affordable housing, income inequality, the sort of role of structural racism. That from what they named the precipitants, these are those individual risk factors that we keep coming back to. And they used an analogy, which I think is really helpful when I speak to audiences to sort of understand this. So imagine, they said, a game of musical chairs. If you all know the game, let's say there are 10 children at a birthday party, 10 chairs, music plays, kids walk around, the adult removes a chair, and the kids scramble for the remaining 9 chairs. Do a thought experiment where the night before the party, one of the kids sprained their ankle, shows up on crutches that don't really fit, they don't really know how to use them, and if you were to ask yourself before the music stops, which is the kid that's still standing, it'd be a really good bet to say it was this kid who was sort of didn't know how to use their crutches. But if you asked yourself a different question, why when the music stops is there a kid still standing? well, there's a kid still standing because there are only 9 chairs. And with only 9 chairs for 10 kids, either 2 kids are sitting on each other's laps or someone is standing. If that kid had not sprained their ankle and you pulled out a chair, there would still have been someone standing. And conversely, if you had had 10 chairs, that kid would eventually have made their way to sitting. When we think of homelessness, we think of that analogy. The fundamental problem is we don't have enough chairs, and by chairs I mean housing units. But of course, when you have a brutal housing market, the people still standing or homeless are disproportionately going to be those who face the many individual vulnerabilities that you see on the street.
And thinking about musical chairs, Professor Blasi, what is the relationship between homelessness and the high cost of housing?
Well, I think as Dr. Cashel said, it's the ratio of people who need housing to the housing that's available that that drives the number of people on the streets. We're going to go over some maps and national geography. This may be a little hard to see, but this is a chart of that shows the percentage of people who are homeless in various cities in America and the median rents in those. And if you can't see the most furthest upper right city is San Francisco, and down in the lower left among the cities clustered there is Houston. And that difference accounts for a large degree of the variance between what happens in Houston and what happens in San Francisco, although I would credit the good mayor for a lot of what happened in Houston. If we look around the country geographically, and we look beyond median rents, HUD has a definition called rent burdened. That means that you're spending, household spending more than 30% of their income on rent. The red areas here are areas where more than 50% of the people are spending more than 30% of their income on rent. The blue area is more than 40%. And you can see the large clusters of blue and red along the California coast, and or the Pacific coast, rather. So that has to do with the ratios, and this really is a version of the musical chairs. Displayed here are in red are places where there are 30 or less units for that are affordable to 100 extremely low-income households. And extremely low-income households are 30% or less of the median income. And as you can see again, the cluster there is in primarily in the West and in the Ninth Circuit. To be a little more granular here, these are some of the larger urban areas in the Ninth Circuit. I didn't include all the ones in California because California would dominate the chart. But I think the really interesting thing to look at are the columns on the right, which have to do with the third column is the number of homeless persons per 1,000 population, which ranges from 2.1 in Phoenix to 8.9 in San Francisco. And then if you look at the adjacent column, this is the average rent for a one-room efficiency apartment in those places. And if you do the math, the San Francisco rents are 4.4 times higher than Phoenix, and San Francisco homelessness is 4.2 times Phoenix. And if you look at the numbers for Portland and Los Angeles, they're roughly the same. Seattle's a little bit of an outlier here. And that's primarily having to do with some mismatch between the geography. I did want to back up and talk a little bit more about this sort of a chart. Now, this chart talks about and demonstrates correlation. And as we all know, correlation is not causation. But this is a good place to start when you're looking for an analysis. The correlation is roughly the line that would go through the middle of these. If you did this chart for something else that might be attributed as a cause for homelessness, like drugs, for example, you would find that you don't see anything like this. For example, Oregon is fourth out of the 50 states in the rate of homelessness, but 34th in the use of by people of methamphetamines. Washington, fifth in homeless, but 38th in use of meth, which is the most common drug on the street.
That's a great point. We now know there are many unhoused individuals in the Ninth Circuit. Dr. Cushell, can you talk to us a little bit about who are the homeless in our communities?
Sure. So I'm going to talk a little bit about our study that we released in late June called Toward a New Understanding, the California Statewide Study of People Experiencing Homelessness, or as we call it, because it's a mouthful, CASPA. CASPA was the largest representative study of homelessness in the U.S. in over three decades, and the first to intentionally include folks, whether or not they use services, whether or not they were sheltered, unsheltered, rural areas, urban areas. It is a statewide study of California, and in California, we have 12% of the U.S. population, but 30% of those experiencing homelessness and 50% of those experiencing unsheltered homelessness. I think our results bear a lot of resemblance to what we would do in many parts of the Ninth Circuit. Not to belabor the point, but we basically divided the state into eight regions. In each region, we fed every bit of information about all the counties and let a computer model choose one county from each region that we could then aggregate to be representative of the state as a whole. In each of those counties, we used very, very careful methods to get a random sample of all of the adults experiencing homelessness in that area. We administered a survey to them. We had teams out on riverbeds and encampments and shelters doing random sampling. Everyone got a survey. About one in eight of the folks got what's called an in-depth interview, where after the survey, we would select them to turn on the microphone and just talk to them about their experience to really try to understand a little more of the how behind the what. We did it all in English and Spanish and used interpreters for other languages. So at certain points, we had ASL interpreters out in encampments helping us do the study and other things. We did 3,200 surveys and 365 in-depth interviews. All of the results are weighted like the census weights things to draw statewide estimates.
And I think we can say it's the most scientific, largest study of the homeless ever conducted. And the executive summary is on your phone in your materials.
And we really were really obsessively scientifically rigorous because we know how charged this issue was and we wanted to be super careful with what we found. And so some of the top line findings, and you can read more in the online, is that first of all, contrary to myths, and by the way, these myths have never been supported by any research, and we again found that they're not supported, 90% of the people who are experiencing homelessness in California had their last stable housing in California, 75% of whom remained in the county where they had last been housed. I will say a significantly higher proportion of the people in the study were born in the state than Californians overall. As a New York-born Californian, I'm on the other side of that. People who experienced homelessness, we looked at where they were before they became homeless. 19% exited directly from an institution, and I will tell this audience that those institutions were primarily long-term jail stays or imprisonment, which made up 14% of the overall sample, and that was a bit of an underestimate because we found, for instance, 6% exited immediately from state or federal prison, but 10% had exited state or federal prison in the 6 months before they became homeless. Many went to temporary housing.
49% came from what we called non-leaseholder situations. These were folks who were housed. They had been in that housing for some time, but they didn't have legal rights to that housing, meaning they were doubled up with friends or family. They were not people who had a lease or their name on a sublease. And a third came from leaseholder situations. That also includes folks with mortgages, folks who are homeowners, but that was a very small percentage, about 3%. At the base of the problem was this mismatch between low income and high housing costs. We looked at people's total household incomes in the 6 months prior to homelessness, and the median household income was $960 a month. This is in a state where a one-bedroom apartment, the median rent is $1,700 a month. I will tell you that that median surprisingly didn't vary between our very high-cost regions of the state and the low-cost regions of the states. People were just desperately poor all over the place. And people had very limited warning prior to losing their housing, a median of 5 days before they knew that they were going to become homeless. Those who were non-leaseholders had a median of days. They were generally sort of staying on the goodwill of friends or family. Things exploded, and they had to leave. Leaseholders had a median of 10 days. They would get an eviction notice and just leave. They really didn't have much in the way of warning. It's really important to note that there's really no way of talking about homelessness without calling out that it is fundamentally an issue of racial injustice. I just want to remind this audience that in our country, the primary means of intergenerational wealth transfer has been through home ownership. And until relatively recently in our collective history, there was legal discrimination in home ownership before the Fair Housing Act of 1969, racial covenants leading to segregated neighborhoods, redlining, which restricted access to mortgage in segregated neighborhoods, leaving black and brown households basically out of access to the post-World War II increase in home ownership. Even though that has been illegal for a long time, we still live in those formerly redlined areas. You could guess the racial makeup of a neighborhood by looking at those old redlining maps. And even though it is now not legal, you see things like the predatory lending crisis in 2008 disproportionately impacting black and brown folks. We know through secret shopper studies that there's ongoing discrimination in the rental housing market, such that black and brown households wind up paying more for lower quality housing. And we know that there's well-described differential access and discrimination in the criminal justice system, employment, and educational discrimination. Thus, it's perhaps no surprise that black Americans are at 3- to 4-fold increased risk of homelessness. You can see this in national data, where you see this disproportionality. Pacific Islanders are actually the single most disproportionate group, followed by black and indigenous individuals. And we certainly found that in CASPA, where the majority of the sample were disproportionately Latinx folks, particularly black folks. 26% of the sample were identified as black, and 12% identified either as their sole racial identity or shared racial identity as Native American, compared to 1% and 3% of the population in California.
And what about the relationship between incarceration and homelessness?
So there is a really tight relationship between incarceration and homelessness for all the reasons you could imagine. Incarceration records creating barriers to employment, combined with explicit discrimination. People who have been incarcerated are at tenfold more likely to experience homelessness. If you've been in prison once, you have a rate nearly 7 times higher than the general population. In our study, we found that 37% of all adult Californians experiencing homelessness had been in state or federal prison. 77% had been in jail. In the 6 months prior to homelessness, 20% had left jail. 10% had left state or federal prison. And perhaps equally shockingly, during the course of their homelessness, 30% had a short-term jail stay. If your jail stay is more than 3 months, it resets your episode. So definitionally, these were all jail stays of less than 3 months. 30% of our participants had been in jail for between 1 day and 89 days during their episode of homelessness.
And to put a face to that, this...
Before you do that, yeah. One of the aggravating factors to this, and a lot of well-meaning cities pass ordinances that allow apartments to not rent to felons. In fact, when I was a council member early on in my career, I helped promote those ordinances to make safer apartment complexes. If look at those stats, if you're a felon and you come out of prison and half of the apartments that you have access to will not rent to you because you are a felon, where are you going to go?
Thank you. Thank you for that point. This is a photograph of my client, Donald Allen. I'm going to tell you just a little bit about him with the permission of his sister. He's shown here on the first day of his release from prison after 25 years of incarceration. He's shown here with our firm's former paralegal as they took a selfie after eating his first meal in the free world. He was released in part due to his role as a witness in an important court proceeding. At the time of his release, Mr. Allen was 70 years old with significant mental and physical health challenges. Although he was initially provided transitional housing, he encountered difficulties at every turn and ended up homeless. His challenges included his mental and physical health problems, as we learned about yesterday, childhood abuse and trauma, unemployment, and he was the victim of a theft. His loving family lived far away in Texas, where he could not move due to parole restrictions. He, of course, had a felony record. For a time, after he lost his transitional housing, he lived in a tiny home, which we'll hear about later, in Los Angeles, where he struggled to reach the communal restroom due to his disability. He then lived in he lost that placement after he was hospitalized. He lived in a truck for a time. He died homeless about a year to the date after his release, in a temporary hotel room, an SRO in Los Angeles, paid for by a stranger. Although many people tried to help Mr. Allen, he did not have the kind of intensive services or caseworker that might have made this tragic result different. And having put a name and a face to the tragedy, we know there are better outcomes. Mayor Parker, please tell us more about Houston.
I do get a lot of attention for the work that we did in Houston, and we have outperformed every other major city, but you, and pictures of me back in the day, before the hair. There were some advantages in Houston, and one of the biggest is that we are the one of the most affordable major cities in America. But surprisingly, too, we receive no state dollars for the city of Texas. We're a low-tax, low-service state. The state doesn't fund cities.
And just if we could just say that in 2012, you had the sixth largest homeless population in the United States. And by 2020, overall homelessness had decreased by 54% in the three counties that make up your continuum of care.
Absolutely. Houston's the fourth largest city. We had the sixth largest population. And the part of the being able to address it is that we were on our own. As I said, I was saying, there's no state funding to cities, no state funding for homelessness, and we had the opportunity to address it directly. But how do you address a problem where no one entity has overall control of it? You're getting cooperation from groups that you cannot compel. You're trying to align agencies that don't utilize resources that you actually control, and you're imposing tough love on folks who have essentially nothing, and you have to make it work. And it's a little bit like the current movie, was it Everything Everywhere All at Once?
Yes.
You have to do all of it at the same time. You also have to contend with, I mentioned earlier, well-meaning local ordinances or practices such as, we want a safe apartment complex, don't rent to felons. And yet, if you look at the number of the proportion of felons in certain communities, you're creating your own problem. But then you have the situation of NIMBYs, cave people, and bananas, and NIMBYs not in my backyard, cave people, citizens against virtually everything, and bananas, which is build absolutely nothing anywhere near anyone. And the solution to all of this came serendipitously to me, and that is that the Obama administration made an initiative to try to house homeless veterans. And they pushed it out nationwide, and they made money available to house veterans, bash dollars. And Houston was one of the cities that said, all right, let's see if we can take these dollars and do something with it. And it gave me an amazing opportunity, because what I did, because this was new money, so I wasn't messing with anybody's revenue stream, and I brought all of the agencies into one room together, and I said, all right, we're going to do something for veterans. And the challenge was, could you house 100 homeless veterans in 100 days? We did 101 in 100 days. They said, okay, we're going to do it again. And we did it again, and we did it again, and by then I had a new paradigm, and I also knew every agency, what they were good at, what they weren't good at. And then here's the secret sauce. I burned through a whole lot of political capital by moving people's resources, because there was no other entity that, again, the state wasn't involved, all of the federal dollars that flowed through came through the city of Houston, and I said, all right, you're Agency A, you're better at this. I'm going to put all the money that I can into you to do this. Agency B, you're not very good at that, but you're good at this other thing. You get to do this other thing. You can go raise all the private money you want, but you're not going to get another dime of public money to do what needs to be done. We also, at that time, most agencies now are all on systems, databases that communicate with each other. We weren't talking to each other. Our agencies, everybody had their own legacy system, forced everybody into the same system, so we could track people through the system. Houston's 640 square miles, the metro area, 1,500 square miles. Easy to lose people. So we had to force everybody to communicate as agencies. And then we had to, again, in a different way, optimize the resources that we were using. And that is that we interviewed, and these pictures are from a survey we did. We went on the streets and we did, I think, 814 individual interviews with homeless folks to find out what our population looked like, so we had actual data. Then we went out to the business community, explained what we wanted to do, what our survey said, and what our commitment was to try to address the problem. And here is where I often become the skunk at the picnic, and that is that we have civility ordinances in Houston, and I know there's different rulings in different parts of the country, but you cannot pitch a tent or sleep on a sidewalk or roll out your sleeping bag on any sidewalk in downtown Houston, and we enforced it. And not because we don't care and not because we weren't working really hard to deal with the homeless, but in order to get the business community buy-in and in order to get the support from the philanthropic organizations, I had to show them that we could have a safe city that welcomed everybody, but also that we were doing things to place people. And I'm happy to have private conversations with anybody, and all the records of what we did are available. What I like to describe it is that picture yourself on the Titanic. I mastered a process where every one of those lifeboats left completely full, one after another, very timely, but the ship is still going down, because all of the factors that were putting people on the street are still there. And that's the overall challenge, and at some point we're going to have to grapple with how do we turn off the spigot that puts people into this system, and how do we provide enough housing to keep them off the streets while we deal with their other problems. Stop there.
Yes, and the contrast between the point in time count in Houston, where I was born, in San Francisco, where I live, is quite stark. And Dr. Kuchel, if you could just speak very briefly about some of the challenges facing San Francisco, which I think our audience is pretty familiar with.
Sure. I mean, it's striking how much San Francisco does that's actually similar. We don't have Mayor Parker. I think it's worth pointing out how many of the things that Mayor Parker did that San Francisco does do. What's the huge difference? Houston has some of the lowest housing costs anywhere in the country, and San Francisco has some of the highest housing costs. We have a few other disadvantages. We are very geographically compact. Not only is it hard to build housing, we are actually one of the densest cities as it is. We have extraordinarily high income disparities. The Bay Area, for a period of time, created 10 new jobs for every new unit of housing. It wasn't a surprise that homelessness went up. We have, although we're a contiguous city and county, so it should make decision-making easier, I think in a very heightened, sort of angry political climate, decision-making remains fractured. Even though we have the same coordinated entry system, we were one of the first places in the country to have a multi-sector coordinated system so that the jails could see if someone was in the hospital and if someone was homeless, and all of those data were shared for frontline providers. It's still on a larger scale, our decision making is quite politicized and fractured. And for anyone who's been in San Francisco, there was probably a very major policy failure that is related to the difficulty building housing, which was all of the services effectively were concentrated in one tiny area. And unfortunately, that tiny area is not only is it terrible to have people who are all struggling all in the same area. So if you're, let's say, trying to get clean, everyone around you is using, it's not great. It also, as you've probably noticed, abuts downtown. So it is right next to our tourist sector, right next to our business sector, right next to our government sector. I will say one thing is that a few years ago, there was this proposition passed with local dollars. And while all the surrounding areas, homelessness is going up, San Francisco's is stable or even going down a little bit. It is not enough, and it is frustrating, and it's still catastrophic, but you can actually see the effect of those local dollars. People sometimes confuse the denominator when they're talking about how much money we're spending, because what they'll do is they'll take how much San Francisco spends on homelessness and divide it by the point in time count of the people who are currently experiencing homelessness. Most of those dollars are going to people who were homeless 10 or 15 years ago, who San Francisco is continuing to pay for their rent. They are stably housed in supportive housing in San Francisco. Those dollars count against what San Francisco spends on homelessness, but those folks aren't homeless. So the denominator-numerator problem makes it look like we're spending this outrageous amount of money for every person who's homeless. Most of those monies are being spent because the city can't draw down federal dollars to pay for rental subsidies. Only 1 in 4 people in this country who qualify for federal rental subsidies receive them.
Right, and that was something I didn't understand at all before I started talking to you all. And we promised you solutions, short-term, long-term. Professor Blasi is going to take you through some of the short-term ideas.
To begin with, it's important, I think, to distinguish what shelter is and what housing is. That may seem obvious, but in fact, there's a kind of a spectrum between shelter and housing. Shelter, frankly, is just a place to sleep for tonight, and many shelters are just for one night, and there's no guarantee of a second night. They also offer a bed for a few hours, and they have a lot of restrictions on whether you can, how much property you can bring in, how much property you have to give up, how many of your possessions you have to give up, whether you have to separate from a partner or a pet or other things that are important to you. That's a shelter. Housing, there's a housing code definition, and it's basically places where people live that are greater than 64 square feet. One of the reasons, and we'll come back to this, that tiny homes are 64 square feet is that at 65 square feet, housing codes tend to kick in because they're based on international housing codes. This difference really matters. It certainly matters to the people who are in housing or in these alternatives to housing, which are often called interim measures. The idea of interim housing is that it's for a period of time until you can get into real housing. The problem is, if there isn't any real housing, then people get stuck in the interim housing and it becomes de facto permanent housing. And now, in fact, there's a new term in the bureaucrats speak in Los Angeles called permanent interim housing. I'm working to get rid of that, but in fact, that's what it is, so it's an accurate description. what housing is related to what Mayor Parker was talking about in terms of a home. It's not just a roof and walls. It's basically a place of stability, a place of predictability. In the old common law phrase, it's that place to which one returns in seasons of repose. That's adopted in California statutes and many others. It means it's sort of your home base. It's where you engage in daily activities. It's where you can have some privacy. You can have some autonomy. You can speak with who you want to at the times that you want to. It makes life worth living. And importantly for the rest of us, it has a lot to do with whether people are able to deal with the other challenges that they have. If you would want people to leave encampments, the closer you get to being able to offer an alternative that's closer to housing, the less you have to do anything to encourage them to do that. In fact, if you offer people actual housing, the evidence is 95% roughly will accept actual housing. And we'll go through some alternatives in a second, and I can give you some of those numbers. But in terms of what's important to unhoused people, the only way to find out what that is to ask them. And in my 40 years of experience in doing this, every big policy failure we've had came about because no one spent 30 seconds thinking about how would that situation look if I were in that situation. You can make a lot of progress just by asking people and taking some perspective from them. At the beginning of these alternatives, this isn't really an alternative. It's authorized campgrounds, safe parking lots. It's basically where you can camp without risking arrest. They tell you where instead of where you can't. Shelter, I've gone through that. This is a shelter in San Diego, 160 beds and bunk beds full of strangers.
Professor Blasi, I know I gave you the notes saying it's time to move a little quicker, but could you explain why the safe camping costs money? The first, go back to the parking lot and just quickly tell everyone.
Sure. So
what it costs.
So you would think that shelter is cheaper than housing. That's one of the sales pitches. Quite often, shelter is more expensive than actual real housing. This parking lot on the left is in Los Angeles. It's 70 spaces with the painted triangles. The city paid $2,800 per month for those painted rectangles on a parking lot. And almost all that money, some of it went
for
to rent, renting the lot.
For each tent.
For each space, $2,800, not for the lot. So, and you can get an apartment in Los Angeles still for $1,700.
If you could find one,
but with $2,800, you could certainly find something better than a rectangle on a parking lot. The reason they're so expensive is because all the money goes into expenses you don't have when you have real housing, like an enormous amount of security and a lot of consultants and a lot of service. So, and some of it goes to things you really need, like services. The same goes with safe parking lots. They're not as cheap as you would think, even though they're just a parking lot. So I mentioned bridge housing before. This is typically, these are bridge housing units in Los Angeles. They're usually 2 or 3 months if you're lucky. They have limited privacy and the same kinds of rules with respect to partners and pets and so on as shelter. We talked about tiny homes. These are the tiny homes on the West Los Angeles Veterans Administration campus. These are the 64 square feet version. There are 100 of them. They're occupied by people who were sleeping just outside the chain link fence at a 384 acre plot of land that was donated to the government for veterans housing. Interestingly though, tiny homes are much preferred to street encampments. If you offer people in an encampment, the experience across the West, at least, is if you offer them a tiny home, they'll leave the encampment. This is one of two tiny home villages in Portland. They have plans for six. This one opened just last month.
But of course, with tiny homes, there are some security risks.
Yeah, one of the problems with tiny homes is they have no bathroom. They do have a lock and a key, which a tent doesn't have. But in order to go to the bathroom, say for in the middle of the night, you've got to go to a common building. And that's one reason that that you have to have so much security. So you're not paying for plumbing, you're paying for security to watch people because they don't have plumbing. Here's a version that has plumbing. These are hotels, motels, hospitality properties. We learned during COVID that this was an easy, effective way to get people off the streets, especially if they were at high risk of COVID. Originally, they were just master leases and so on, but now in California and several other states in the Ninth Circuit, there are efforts to acquire motels for short-term housing. One thing that we've also learned is that with about $1,200 worth of a kitchenette, you can convert a motel room into something approximating a very small apartment.
We talked yesterday about the contrast in price between Houston and what we're hearing about here. Yeah.
None of this stuff is cheap if it's done badly, which a lot of things, especially when you don't have a single focused local government doing it, but it's all spread around. If you do it badly, it's all expensive. But here's a version of housing that will produce actual units of housing with bathrooms in suite, as they say, even in the homeless business. 132 square feet with a kitchenette, and they're cost-effective because they're modular, and you can use a piece of flat land for 2 or 3 years, and then when it has to be taken for some other use, you can move them somewhere else without losing your investment. But I think we all agree, up here on the panel at least, that the only long-term solution is actual housing, and these are two really good projects in San Francisco and Houston.
That's right. So let's talk more about long-term tried-and-true solutions. Maybe start with you, Mayor Parker, and then move to Dr. Cushell. Or no, I think we were going to do prevention first.
Well, one of the things I want to come back to is the idea of permanent supportive housing. Permanent housing, but also permanent support. And going back to the comment about a lot of the money that's being spent in San Francisco is to support people who were formerly homeless and are in housing, but they're being subsidized. We're serious when we say permanent supportive housing is permanent on both pieces. That a lot of these folks are not capable of living on their own without effective they need effective case management. So this, you're maintaining the system that supports the people who have been taken off the street, and then you are working to bring people off the street, again, without touching any of the issues that push them onto the street, which is why we're constantly playing catch-up.
Yeah, I mean, I think it's important to say there's really, no way to get to the other side of this without actually addressing the housing problem. There is no magic here. You can have every bit of coordination, every bit of even awesome services, and if there isn't a house to put someone in, they're still gonna be homeless. But there is a lot we can do. There's a lot of room to improve our rental subsidies. Right now, as I mentioned, the federal government only provides for 1 in 4 people who meet the very strict requirements to get subsidies, only 1 in 4 actually get them. There are lots of other problems. They can be hard to use because of discrimination and whatever. But if the federal government decided to up that number, it would do a few things. One is it would keep people who were housed continue to be housed. We've been following people for over a decade now in Oakland to see what happens. They started homeless and we just follow them and meet with them every 6 months. Good news is 80% regained housing. Bad news, 50% of them lost their housing again within a year. What was the one thing? We looked at everything, drug use, you know, subsidies, whatever. The one thing that kept them housed was having a subsidy. The other thing that having rental subsidies would do is it would spur the generation of affordable housing. For people who are homeless, these are desperately poor people, they're never going to pay enough to pay the ongoing costs of housing. And when I talk to my affordable housing colleagues, they say that they can sometimes scrape together the money to create the housing. What they can't do is pay for the ongoing maintenance. So that is like prevention on a broad scheme. If we could get to reducing that disparity, California, 24 units of housing that's affordable and available for every 100. Extremely low-income households. We're a million units short. If we could shrink that deficit, we would have a lot less homelessness and we would keep people who got housed, rehoused. There's what's called targeted prevention. Things like eviction defense is extremely important. We know that getting people access to the legal system, getting people access to an attorney is one of the best things to keep people from being evicted, to know their rights, to be able to exercise those rights. You heard from our study that most of those who, more people experienced homelessness from a non-leaseholder situation, but most of those folks had been evicted previously. So if you could stop the evictions or slow down the evictions, you could do a lot. They're really excellent sort of targeted prevention. New York City has this en masse, where if you are at risk of homelessness, you present yourself. There's sort of signs in the buses and subway system. Do you think you're going to lose your housing? Come to this place. They actually need to figure out who's most at risk, because amongst lots of people who look like they're at risk, only some people are actually at risk. So they basically ask you a series of questions. And if you score high enough, that they think you have a pretty good chance of being homeless. By the way, this the single biggest predictor is ever having been homeless before. But other things go into the model. You get access to a suite of services, which are very flexible. It includes things like money to pay back rent, a caseworker, a lawyer, or a paralegal to help you, you know, navigate with your landlord, or things as simple as like a bunk bed. Your sister's willing to take you in, but there's no space on the floor to sleep. They will literally buy you a bunk bed. That has been shown to decrease entrances into homelessness. LA County housed thousands and thousands of people with local dollars. For every person they housed, 1.7 became homeless. We can't solve this crisis unless we turn off that. The other things, though, this is a term that has been maligned and sort of talked about badly. I just want to unpack it for you a bit, which is housing first. Mayor Parker noted that housing first is in opposition to what we used to do called treatment first. This philosophy initially brought forward by the George W. Bush administration and then sort of put into federal law by the Obama administration differentiates an old failed policy, which was that you required people to get treatment as a condition of getting any housing supports. The problem was, and I speak about this as a physician who spends a lot of my time doing addiction medicine and trying to do mental health care. I'm an internist, but a lot of internists do sort of mental health care, is that when someone is homeless, when they are trying to figure out where their next meal is going to come from, if they're going to have an encounter with the police, if they're going to be assaulted, they have no mental space to take up treatment. And I offer it, I beg, I plead, and what they say to me is, "Doc, not now. Not until I'm housed." And what has been shown empirically, if you flip the switch, if you say, "Let's start with the housing, and then we are going to flood you with supports and offers of services if that's what you need," what you see is not only do people maintain their housing, but importantly, they take up those treatment services. So let me tell you, if you're skeptical, that the County of Santa Clara, where Silicon Valley was, approached us a number of years ago and asked us to help them implement a permanent supportive housing program. This is done on a housing first philosophy for the most impaired folks. That means permanent subsidy plus wrapped around services. We basically did huge data mining and found the 400 most difficult folks in the county, the folks who had the most interaction with the justice system, psychiatric emergency departments, psychiatric hospitals, hospitals, and ERs. And we just said, we're not even going to go find them. We know they're going to show up. We know the police are going to find them. We just put flags in all of their charts. And what we did was the police would call us, jail would call us, a psych ER would call us, and they say, we have one of your folks, we're supposed to call you. We would go and meet them at like 7 in the morning. They would have been up all night in jail or in the ER. And we'd say to them, I know you've never heard from me before, but I want you to sign these 50 pieces of paper so that Dr. Kuchel can follow you for the next like 7 years throughout the system. So they had to sign up for the study. And if you do that, you'll get a 50-50 chance of getting housing. So that's much worse than offering people housing because they have to agree to be in the study. Of about 400 people we approached, 3 did not agree to sign the 50 pieces of paper allowing me to track them for years. We then randomized them in real time. We only had a limited number of units, which is why we had to randomize people. We randomized them at the moment. And then if they were randomized to the intervention, the system was on, you know, they had to try to house them. We got, when we published a study 4 years in, we had 86% of the people housed. By the time we finished it a few months ago, at 7 years, 91% of those became housed. But more importantly, we followed them for 7 years. And once housed, they stayed on average housed for 90% of their nights. So if they went to jail for more than 30 days, they were no longer housed. So we really, they stayed housed. What did we find? Psychiatric emergency department visits plummeted compared to the control group. By the way, 30% of the control group also got PSH, which makes it harder to show a difference. Use of drug treatment skyrocketed. People needed those supports for those 7 years. And these folks were really impaired. They're probably going to need those supports for life, but it works. Housing First works. Housing First doesn't always mean this much services. The person who's your Uber driver, they might just need a rental subsidy, but for the person who's really impaired, they need this suite of services. But if we had gone up to those people and said, you need to go today into drug treatment, and then we'll consider you homeless, I can tell you that they would not have said yes. But since we started with the housing, they said yes, eventually got the mental health treatment, substance use treatment, and their lives stabilized.
And yesterday also we were talking, Mayor Parker, about some of the alternatives to incarceration as a way to prevent homelessness as well.
One of the things that I did in Houston, and a lot of cities have some version of this, is that I discovered that the city of Houston still had a city jail, and we were under a consent decree. I was desperately trying to get out from under the jail and send all my prisoners to the county. We were arresting 19,000 people a year for being under the influence in public, and I had to lower the head count. And we created what we call the Houston Center for Sobriety, and any person who is picked up under the influence, passed out on the street, instead of being taken to jail, which is what we used to do, is taken to the Center for Sobriety. They have to stay a minimum of 4 hours or until they are sober and able to exit on their own, but they have no criminal record, and it solved a lot of problems. But one of the interesting ones is that costs about a third as much as putting somebody in jail, you know, managing the med staff there and the social workers there. But it also put my police officers back in the call for service loop in a fraction of the time of booking somebody into jail. Like 15 minutes, you go, you drop them off, social workers take them in, they sleep on a pallet, and they're gone again. An additional benefit was that we were able to screen out the frequent flyers, the ones that were coming through regularly, and then have a more targeted intervention. They are not required to go into any treatment program by being in, unless, you know, if they're there every, you know, once a week over time, we can compel. But we had the data to be able to make those informed decisions. So they're. And it also solves, again, the problem of so many of these folks are being arrested. Spending a night or two in jail. Let's talk about another myth, and that is that the people who are homeless have no resources. So you're a veteran, you're on the street, you may have disability benefits coming in, you may have Social Security benefits coming in. You can't access those benefits because you don't have a fixed address where people can find you. But even if you do, if you get picked up because you're passed out on the street, you've broken that, you've broken your cycle. You have a day job, day labor job. You can't go to that day labor job. You've lost it. So we're constantly interrupting the lives of these folks simply because we don't want to look at them passed out on the street.
And what about encampment sweeps? How do those affect continued homelessness?
And this goes back to the bridge housing that Gary was talking about. What the only thing that really we discovered that works, if we started by taking individuals off the street, and they miss their friends, they miss their network. Now when we do an entire encampment, we have a navigation center, the whole group comes in. Now they are in minimally private spaces, like cubicles, essentially. They're not in a big shelter where they're all in bunk beds, but they at least know the people they are sharing space with. They're able to bring some limited amount of their stuff. You have to be respectful of pets. Would you go away and leave your pet? You know, you can't even evacuate in a hurricane now. The federal government specifies that you have to take people's pets too. But we expect homeless people, that's something they love, to leave that pet behind if they want a home. So what we do is we do it in groups. We do a navigation center, and they may spend 2 months at that navigation center, but by the end of that period, the entire encampment has gone to permanent housing. And then we wipe the tent area or the encampment area so that it doesn't get backfilled, and then we move on to the next one. But it's a constant process.
And Dr. Cushell, what are the costs of, you know, life on the streets in terms of, I mean, everyone's wondering, you know, how do we afford this permanent supportive housing? But there are costs for not doing it, right?
I mean, there are tremendous costs to the individual, right? In our study, 10% had been sexually assaulted during this episode of homelessness. A third had been physically assaulted during this episode of homelessness. As a healthcare provider, I can tell you people become homeless and everything else falls apart. Their chronic disease gets out of control, the death rates are astronomical, et cetera. But there are also incredible public costs. Like, we spend a lot of money right now on things like managing the crisis on a safe parking lot, or, you know, that costs $2,600 a month a person. All the policing costs, all of the excess hospitalization costs. The homeless population is aging. Almost half of the single homeless adults are 50 and older. Our studies have shown they look much more like adults in their 70s and 80s in the general population. We're going to start seeing skyrocketing nursing home costs, which are an enormous drain on Medicaid. Most of those costs are borne by the Medicaid system. That's an astronomical expense. So we are paying for homelessness. Obviously, the worst costs are borne by the people who are homeless, but we're all paying. If you're in San Francisco and you're a business leader, you know it's devastating to the business community. It's devastating to the tourism community. I think we have to grapple with the fact that ending this crisis is going to cost a lot of money. There's no way around it. We are not going to get out of this cheaply, but I think it's worth noting that we are spending a tremendous amount of money doing a horrible job not trying to manage this ongoing calamity.
Yeah, and while my colleagues are gathering up audience questions, I'll just ask some myself, which is, these are scenes from near my office, near your office. How do we get from these scenes to these, and what can I do as a citizen, as a member of a community in the Ninth Circuit? What are some things individuals can do?
You know, I'm going to take it from the city standpoint, and again, Houston is an outlier not having zoning, which means that we can redevelop areas really quickly. I was able to put 2,500 units of housing on the ground in about an 18-month period. A lot of places that would take that long just to get the permits to do it. Density ordinances, neighborhood resistance. We have to have these conversations, and we have to push through, build more housing at all price points, at all levels, and really the density is going to be key to a lot of this. I will say that I'm happy to show off some of the projects in Houston. SRO, single room occupancy units, are one bedroom apartments for formerly homeless folks. They are can be some of the nicest apartments in a neighborhood. Just because it is for ultra low income or formerly homeless folks doesn't mean it has to be of poor quality. It can become a neighborhood anchor and lift everything up, but you have to be able to build it in the first place. The other is how we deal with the people on the street. And I'm going to toss that to Dr. Cashel.
I was going to say, as an individual citizen, hold your electeds at all levels of government accountable for this. Don't let Congress and the federal folks off the hook. Mayors get blamed, but it's often the federal government that has the most they can do. Show up to those zoning meetings, because I can tell you that everyone who doesn't want low-income housing built in their community shows up, and I show up and speak
happy
out.
People don't show up to tell you they're happy
to tell you they're happy level. I show up and I say I live in this neighborhood, I would love this low-income housing. My husband's an attorney and a saint and doesn't mind me going to these meetings on Tuesday nights to give my 1 minute of testimony, but it is worth showing up. But in terms of individuals on the street, this is my plea as a physician. We are in an overdose crisis. Carry Narcan with you. You can watch a 10-minute video. Probably a lot of you are trained in CPR. This is as effective or more effective than CPR. It's really easy to use, and you can literally save a life. And as a physician, I can tell you it's really fun to save lives. It's really good, easy to use. So carry Narcan. Watch the YouTube video and use it. It's okay to talk to people who are homeless. You know, I think it can be frightening if someone is internally preoccupied and sort of talking to themselves. One of the things I educate people on is if someone is assaulting someone or truly threatening, you obviously need to get help. Know your community's resources. Hopefully those are non-police responders. A lot of communities now have non-police mental health responders who are just going to de-escalate the situation. But if someone's just talking to themselves and that person, you know, isn't there, it's okay to leave them be. They are doing their own thing, and interrupting that is actually can disrupt it and can escalate them. And be a human being. If you feel safe, I go and buy food for folks and just sit down on the street corner and share a meal with them. I take orders and go into a local restaurant and get them some food and sit and talk to folks. People who are homeless feel so ignored and humiliated and just left out, that sometimes if you feel comfortable doing that, it's a small gesture, but it can make folks feel like part of the community.
Yes.
We should also work on, if your community doesn't have a non-police response for mental health crisis, you need to push your local elected officials to make that happen. The vast majority of the bad police shootings across the United States, the worst, are mental health issues involved, and we send a police officer rather than someone who can help that person deal through the crisis. In Houston, we often pair a police officer for safety with a mental health practitioner, but a lot of communities really need to focus on that.
Yes, and each of you has told me not to give money, but rather perhaps to carry some toiletries, Narcan, a piece of fruit, and offer that. We've got a lot of great questions. If I don't get through all of them before 10 o'clock, please come up and talk to our panelists or shoot them an email, or you can shoot me an email and I'll forward it to them. One person, and this sort of goes to something I did, which is I worked at a place in San Francisco that serves dinner to the homeless, and so someone asks about programs like Father Joe's in San Diego, Jewish Family Services, Jewish Family Children and Services, Catholic Charities. Are these groups playing a role in helping? And I think the answer is clearly yes, right?
Yeah, I mean, the nonprofits are doing most of this work. Even when governments get funding for homeless services, most of it goes to nonprofits. A lot of the folks who work in those are on the verge of homelessness themselves. They also are catching a lot of flack right now, as if they were responsible for the problem. A lot of these nonprofits are doing incredible work, and you can get involved by serving a meal, joining a board, giving money, just getting to know them and support them, because they are doing the frontline work often.
I'm going to say, though, a lot of these organizations, and this is one of the things I was able to overcome in Houston, they're great organizations and they're doing good work, but they're operating in parallel. Mm-hmm. They're not converging on a problem. Each of them has a piece. Maybe it's they're providing meals, or they're providing showers, or they're providing job assistance, or whatever, but you're not converging on the problem. And again, pushing the local continuums of care to where they're actually not just about, I want to do a good job in my mission, but I want to do a good job in solving the local problem, makes a big difference.
And you mentioned yesterday that, for example, one group might only help women. And one of our questions is, where are the women? The visible population is mostly male.
It was about 10% in Houston when we did our 800-person survey. What do you see in San Juan?
It's about a third are women, but women are much more likely to be hidden because they need to be hidden. Because their rates, the 10% rate of sexual assault was overall much, much higher in women, and the highest group are trans and non-binary folks, who are even higher than the cis women. So they are not visible for a reason. You know, one in four people experiencing homelessness in the country is a child living with their parents, experiencing homelessness with their parent. Those families are doing everything they can to hide because they know if they're visible, those kids will likely be removed from them. But the women are out there, they're just basically trying not to be found.
One of our questioners asks, why now? What economic or other factors have changed over the decades such that we used to have more or less adequate housing and now we don't? We used to have an economic balance between income and housing costs, and now we don't. We've always had the desperately poor, and we haven't always had this problem.
Well, we could talk about that for some of it is the frayed social safety network. Some of it is generational poverty. It's the, again, the sharp uptick in incarcerations. The foster care system, Gary's thinking about it too.
Well, I would say that poor people are a lot poorer now than they were many years ago. We haven't been building that housing, but in the meantime, nothing has happened really to enable people to get anything in the market. The social safety net was basically dismantled beginning in the Clinton administration. Federal dollars for housing were cut by 80%. So they weren't exactly the good old days, but there was a lot more resources to work with. And talking about resources.
Blue-collar jobs, too.
There's been a transformation of the economy, of course, and maybe that's going to get worse with AI and all that. But, you know, while we're talking about money, I just wanted to emphasize something that Dr. Cashel said, and that is that it costs a lot of money to deal with people on the street. If we are not going to just let people die on the street, it costs a lot more money in emergency room care, in dealing with people through the court system, and all the other systems that they interact with, than it does actually getting them into housing. And there are probably 30 empirical studies that demonstrate that going to permanent supportive housing actually reduces the burden on the public sector.
Yes, and one person wondered what percentage of people who receive the more stable solutions like tiny houses, converted hotels, and modular apartments are employed or regain employment. Do you have a sense of that?
I mean, in our statewide study, people were remarkably disconnected from the labor markets, and that might be about 70% of people had not been in formal employment in the last 2 years, but that might partially be inflated by the pandemic effects, because we did it during the pandemic. You know, the folks with, there's a group of people, probably, you know, 15 to 20% of people who have severe impairments and are gonna be on disability the rest of their lives. But the folks who have less severe impairments can be reintegrated into the job markets. The problem is that these folks are never gonna probably be able to pay market rate rents. But what we see is when you return people to housing, particularly those who are less impaired or who you get before they become more and more impaired. The longer people stay outside, the more impaired they become. A fair number of those people can return to the labor markets, but to be honest, they usually aren't able to pay market rate rents once they return just because of the way the economy is. Our minimum wage just hasn't kept up with the costs of housing.
Yeah, there are a lot of homeless people who are working.
Absolutely.
They're not typically visible homeless people, but there are a lot of low-wage workers who live in their cars somewhere near their place of employment. And maybe they have a family to visit a couple of hundred miles away periodically. Those people are homeless. You're sleeping in the back of your car. There are people that drive for Uber that sleep in that car that they transport you in. So there are people are working, but there's also, I think, a lot of up potential for getting people into some of the lower wage jobs if there's enough support to get them to where they need to go.
Right.
About a third of our homeless population that we interviewed was working,
yeah,
despite
right.
being homeless.
Great. So we are going to need to wrap up for our next panel, history, what is it good for, and make sure you get your 15-minute break. But before we do, starting with you, Dr. Kuchel, what is one thing you'd like people here to remember?
I think, first of all, is that this is a solvable problem, and it's solvable through housing. Push back against the individual narrative. I'm a physician. I'm not afraid of substance use and mental health disorders, but without the housing, there's not much that I can do. And as our team likes to say, hope is a discipline. We can do this if we have the political will to do it.
Professor Blasi.
I would say, spend some time thinking about what it would be like to experience homelessness. And more to the point, find out what homeless people want and will accept and would consider better than where they are, because that might be something that could be arranged. So you don't need professors and other folks prescribing solutions. The people who know what they need are the people themselves. And you can do that in systematic ways, as is being done by some academics, but you can also just spend time talking to folks.
Thank you. And last word to you, Mayor Parker.
We do have to believe that we can solve the problem, but belief isn't enough. Then we have to work on effective methods to solve the problem. And going back to the discussion of are you houseless or are you homeless, we may disagree with the decisions, but these are human beings, and they are making what, in their view, are rational and appropriate decisions about where the safest place is for them to be. And it may be the only place they can be because they can't afford space. But there's a tendency to think, well, we're just going to build more shelters, and if they, you know, what's wrong with them? They turn down shelters. Would you feel safe and comfortable in a bunk bed in a room with 100 strangers, with the bathroom down at the end of the hall? Or would you feel safer in a tent under a bridge with three people that you know well and are gonna watch your back? We're dealing with human beings, and they are making decisions that are in their best interest, in their view, and we have to recognize that.
Well, thank you all. This has been a great honor to work with you, and look forward to further conversation. Thank you for coming.